Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the last talk of today. So I realized that it was a long day with a lot of important concepts, I think, that were presented. And if you feel a little bit tired, then this is something that already we share. I also learned a lot, an enormous amount of different viewpoints, and my head is now full with different concepts. And you will probably see this also in my talk. So I decided that I should be low-key. I would like to go slowly with simple things, so maybe we have a bit of fun at the end of the day. And fun is already what this is supposed to indicate a bit. So the setting. I will be, for the purpose of this lecture series, a non-interacting person. My Hamiltonian looked like this, very much like the Hamiltonian of Professor Chenoy already in the morning. I have this matrix, and all I have to say in the talk has to do with properties of this matrix. So now, what I will begin with the presentation of today is how we can write simple model Hamiltonians for this matrix. And the motivation for going into a model is simple. So maybe you remember that my setting is that I have some kind of a material. It could be silicon with scattering centers, Bohr or nitrogen. And if I wanted to do justice to the full microscopics of this model, even if I would not fully take interactions into account, it would still be formidably complicated, because after all, there are all these molecular wave functions or wave functions of this crystal. For instance, recall that the benzene ring, even a benzene ring, is already something that, from a certain perspective, if not that simple. So it has this, has many orbitals, of course, per carbon atom. But the most important one to understand the Fermi energy are these frontier orbitals. This is a pi orbital, which has a plus sign and a minus sign up there. And if we wanted to do full justice to the microscopics, then we should actually take into account the spatial extension of the wave function, which then would mean to keep track of the orbitals. That's really a lot of information, more than we actually want and need for the purpose of this lecture series. So let's see how we can simplify away from all of these microscopic complications. One important conceptual step to simplify is to say that, after all, we are usually not interested in the properties of the full spectrum, not usually in the properties of the low-lying bands, but usually interested in properties that have to do or live on the order of the temperature in the vicinity of the Fermi energy, which means that actually it would be good enough for us to understand the material properties in a small window around the Fermi energy. So let's discard all those states far away from the Fermi energy. So we focus on the band structure of these materials in the vicinity of EF. That's one simplification. And then another simplification is related to the question whether we actually want all of this spatial information here, or whether a drastic step that we could take wouldn't be good enough for us. A drastic step could be like this. So look at this benzene thing, and then it has all these pi orbitals sitting there. And I could say, and it is true, that the ground state is a linear combination of these atomic orbitals in such a way that all the pluses point upstairs and all the minus signs point downstairs. So let's associate the situation where we have an orbital where everything points upstairs with a one everywhere. And those situations where then the wave function has a node, meaning that it points upstairs down here, up here, and downstairs down there, by its change in the sign, which means I go from 1 to minus 1. If I represent orbitals in such a simple way, just with ones and minus ones, then what I do keep track of is the nodal structure of the orbitals, namely the one with the minus sign here would have a node right in between the plus region and the minus region, and I throw away everything else. That will be the second part of simplification that we are going to use when we talk about tight binding models. So I throw away much, but not all, of the structure of the wave functions. In this spirit, I can now write down a Hamiltonian for this benzene ring. And the one for this ring will look very similar to the Hamiltonian that we had before for the chain that we wrote down and that Alex already wrote down, just with a small twist that this chain will be now put together like it's going to form a loop, and then we are here. So let's write down the Hamiltonian, the hopping matrix Hamiltonian in this spirit. We will then have Hamiltonian H is equal to, it's a matrix. There's an on-site energy for a particle that sits here in that orbital. This on-site energy we are going to denote by epsilon. And then there is a hopping matrix that takes the particle from here to there, which we will denote by minus T. So then this entry means that we have a particle and that from one step to the other can either stay in the spot where it has been. Let's say this is the spot that refers to the first line. Then this will get the weight epsilon. But if we move from here to there, then this happens with the probability amplitude minus T. We can only move from here to there. We have only nearest neighbor hopping. So these guys are all zero. And how many zeros do I have to write? Question mark. Late in the evening, number of zeros is six, right? Four. Right. You got it. I told you. It's really late. It's really late. So it says, yeah, that's okay. Four. But then, is it really true that there's four zeros? Let me come back to this in a second. So let's describe the hopping from here to there. Then it will be epsilon minus T, right? So maybe because we can go from here to there, this is this guy. Or we can go from here to there, this is this guy. There will be a certain number of zeros. Let's say three zeros, because we can go nowhere else. We can go either there or there, but nowhere else. So now we complete this matrix. 0, 0, 0, 0 minus T, epsilon minus T, 0. And then there will be one more. Epsilon here minus T there. Yeah, and now you see we have this guy. And at the moment, this guy is only allowed to move over here. If you also want to move it over there so as to close the ring, then we will need to put hopping matrix elements over here. And then because our matrix is supposed to be Hermitian, it can also have another matrix element down there. Six. I should have six. Something like this. This will be our tight binding representation of benzene. It has as many rows as benzene has carbon atoms. And I have periodic boundary conditions realized by putting a minus T here and a minus T there. That's the simplest model that I could conceive. And now, if I want to make the chain out of this, then I leave this T out. If I want to make this benzene ring a lot more atoms, I want a long chain, then I go into a situation that where I can derive the spectrum for this really easily. So let's say N equals 6 here. N is the number of carbon atoms. In the limit where N goes to infinity, the spectrum of this thing can be obtained via Fourier transformation. We already had it before, and then it looks like this. Good. So that's the logic of our tight binding models. And now, how can I go away from the trivial case of just benzene rings? This I do in an obvious way. Say I can have different lattices. Here I have a two-dimensional structure, which means that not only can I hop from here to there or here to there, but also into another layer. So there will be more hopping matrix elements corresponding to other layers. I can give this tight binding structure not only a cubic lattice, I can have different lattices. One example would be my favorite lattice at the moment. That would be a hexagonal lattice like this. These are the sort of obvious ways to work. And then I can also change the sites. Here I was allowing for one orbital per site. I could have n orbitals per site, which means I get a box. The box is a new unit cell. It can be complicated. I can also allow for the possibility not only to hop from here to there, but from hop to there to there. So these tight binding models have a lot of possibilities to play with, which then is ultimately why they can have rich band structure physics. And what is also guaranteeing us that we will not only be able to model qualitatively a material, but to some extent even quantitatively. And why? How do we do this, even though we discard a lot of atomic information? We do this like this. So you look at this dispersion relation there. I was drawing it for you the other day. Pi over A. And now for the low energy physics, what's interesting for us is the vicinity of the Fermi energy, which sitting at half filling is perhaps here. Or depending on what the filling fraction is, it could also be lower or higher. And now, if the only important thing for the dynamics of the system is the Fermi velocity, which is the case, for instance, if I would like to deal with plasmons in one or two dimensions, then the important parameter that enters, well, let's say plasmon velocities and dispersion relations is the Fermi energy, then I can take this guy as a fitting parameter, and I now fit my tight binding model to the Fermi velocity of the system that I can get via experiments or via more complicated ab initio calculations. And once I fit it, I can expect that those dynamical aspects of the tight binding model that only refer to the Fermi velocity will be faithfully reproduced even in a quantitative way. So as I allow myself not only one side and one Hopping matrix element, meaning two parameters, but many more parameters, I can, if I want to, also model more complicated band structures. And if I do the fitting right, then I can expect that a lot of the information that comes out of these tight binding models is actually quantitative by construction. This is not just a toy. I can actually convert it into something which can become quantitative. Now, I wanted to show you a bit of the beauty of this model in the situation where we now generalize it more a little bit. We now allow for time reversal symmetry breaking, so we introduce a magnetic field. And then what comes out of this is this object over there. Tight binding. Models in magnetic fields. So I would like to break time reversal invariance, which means on the level of my Hamiltonian that what happens to be a symmetric real matrix right now should become a real Hermitian matrix in the sense that the entries are no longer real numbers. They should be complex numbers. A simple way for me to do this is to replace the Hopping matrix element T by T to the I phi. And now phi is a complex parameter that quantifies the strength of the magnetic field. How is phi related to the magnetic flux through the lattice? That's easy to see. Let's say my particle moves around one of the plaquettes. And since I like it present hexagons, it will be a hexagonal plaquette with sides and links 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, then the total flux that the particle picks up while running around one loop is just the sum of all these fluxes per popping process along one of these links. So phi is the sum from 1 to 6, in this case, of these little phis that I've used to decorate these Hopping matrix elements. Now, this is like a gauge field, like a vector potential sitting over there. And now I need to tell you about how to implement this vector potential in my lattice model so that I get a nice picture like this. This is being done in the following way. You see, we realize I want to implement a magnetic field, but I do this via constructing a vector potential. So there is some gauge degree of freedom that I will make use of now in order to come up with a simple way to decorate my lattice with these flux shifts in order to build in a flux like that. Here I'm a bit inconsistent. Even though I like hexagons, here I will do it with a quadratic lattice. And in a second, you will see why it is convenient for me to do this in a quadratic lattice. So all of these links correspond to Hopping matrix elements that I've written here. And now they will look slightly different depending on whether I go from here to here or from here to there. And the difference is easy to see. So when I hop from here to there, I would like to dress my T with a flux phi. Same thing here. Phi, 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 phi. While when I hop from this row to that row, no flux will be attached to those links. But then if I move from here to there, the flux that I will attach will be 2. Oops, I did it the wrong. Yeah, it will be 2 phi. 2 phi, 2 phi, 2 phi, 2 phi, and so on until I have here 4 phi, 4 phi, 4 phi, 4 phi, 4 phi. Yeah, now when I move around this plaquette, then the flux that I'm going to pick up is, I move like this, for instance, then the flux that I'm going to pick up is 2 phi. Here I move in this direction. Here I move backwards, which means T star. T star means I get a flux of minus phi. So the net flux that I'm summing up when I move around this plaquette is phi. And now, as you can easily convince yourself, I have done this carefully enough so that whenever I move around any plaquette, I will pick up the flux phi. Now, if I want to do periodic boundary conditions, then I should identify the flux along this thing, which according to my rule would be 5 phi, with the flux along this link, which would be phi. So what I actually require is, if I call the number of links in this direction L, then what I require is that L times phi is equal to 2 pi j. If that is the case, then 5 phi is equal to phi, or more generally speaking, L phi is equal to 1 phi. That's a condition on my flux quanta in order to get a periodic lattice. So phi should be given by j 2 pi over L times j. Good. This is how we do magnetic fields. And I think it is interesting maybe for you to see how one puts magnetic fields into the system, because that then would allow to study things like quantum Hall effects, or so also one-type binding lattices, for which you need, after all, the magnetic field. So now we have done this. We have taken a large lattice. We have done this dressing with fluxes. We have diagonalized the Hamiltonian. And actually, we did it for several fluxes. And for each choice of the flux, we plot along this axis the spectrum. So I have a big system. Each eigenvalue that I get makes a dot along this line. And this I do for many different fluxes, going from 0 to 1 flux quantum per plaquette. And then I get this funny figure. That figure has a famous name. That's the Hofstadter butterfly. And since it is important that you are being incorporated in my presentation, I need to ask you, who has seen that already before? Many people, right? Excellent. Actually, everybody, right? That's good. One always should start with one talk with something that everybody already knows. Good. So that's the Hofstadter butterfly. I don't want to discuss it any further. This is actually a rich discussion to understand the microscopic details here. One reason, except for the fact that I thought it's a nice picture, why I'm showing this here is because this butterfly has the property that it is sort of self-averaging. Quatsch, nonsense. It's a fractal structure to the extent that this region over there looks a bit like this region over there, looks a bit like this region over there, and so on. And these fractal structures will later on in the lecture play an important role. Okay, so that was an excursion and a sort of repetition of tight binding stuff for magnetic fields. Now, please switch it off. That doesn't work now. Then we have to live with the butterfly for the rest of the lecture. It's not so important, I think. Pardon? J. Integer. J is, thank you, yeah, zero. No, zero probably not. One. One. Okay. 1.5. So now we go move disorder. I would like to talk a little bit about what to do with disorder in the tight binding model. And before I do this, I would like to confront you also with the philosophy that I have when I do disorder in tight binding. And for that reason, I need to talk a bit about ensemble averages. And model ensembles. We had this already before. For instance, Thomas was talking about it. Alex was also alluding to it a bit. Yeah, please. Pardon? I didn't explain the features, and I won't explain. That takes me way too long. I just wanted to motivate you. If you wanted to do a simple exercise, then you could also calculate this object, and it would work like this. You install a tight binding Hamiltonian in, let's say, Mathematica or whatever you like, Python, and then you diagonalize it, and you, along the y-axis, for every eigenvalue that you get, you make a point. And that you repeat for different fluxes, and then you get this pattern. Ensemble averages and model ensembles. So we are after disorder. And let's say on the chemical level, disorder would, for instance, in graphene in my hexagonal lattice, be realized in different ways. One of them could be, for instance, that the carbon atom is being replaced by a nitrogen atom. That would be substitutional disorder. Another way of installing disorder on a microscopic level is that we take one of these carbon atoms that has, oh yeah, that's another question. Let's see how good you are in chemistry. So we have a carbon atom. The carbon atom has three bonds. What is its hybridization status? Pardon? Wow, oh, great. Great. So I learned this only again after I started to work with chemists. Yeah, that's right. So it's all sp2. Excellent. And now we attach a chemical group. Chemists call this functionalization. We functionalize the graphene. And what it means is that we take one of these carbon atoms, for instance, this guy, and make it form a chemical bond with an atom or with a chemical group that sits over there. It could be, for instance, CH3. So we take this guy, give it one more bond, and then it contacts to CH3. It could also be just hydrogen or fluoride. Or there are many different possibilities. So once I have taken the carbon atom from three neighbors to four neighbors, I have promoted it from sp2 to, yes, sp3, which means that carbon atom is certainly very different from all these carbon atoms, which is something that I could also model in my tight binding model. So how would I model this? Any suggestion? Yeah, on-site energy. How would I model this? Yeah, but what else? I need a little more than that. How would I model that? Pardon? Yeah, the model, they will also be, but that's not it. That's right. They will also be need to be modified. I would agree with that. But I need a little more than this too. So I have an on-site energy that I play with. I have hopping parameters that I play with. And what else do I play with? I could do that. So what I'm having in mind is that my Hilbert space, as I wrote it here, is only referring to the graphene, the carbon atoms in the plane. And now if I put an add atom over there, or another group, then I could also take care of it by giving it additional sites. Right? So I could change the topology of my Hamiltonian. I can also do that by looking at this guy, for instance. Here I do something similar. I take my lattice, and now I put in a defect by just taking away one carbon atom. Then it looks like this. This would be a vacancy. And that I can also deal with by changing the Hilbert space, meaning the number of sites that I work with. So these are different ways to install disorder, and they are kind of experimentally, all of them are experimentally relevant. No question, yes, yes.
So if you block that, I mean, if you add another hook, isn't the site simply dead?
I would agree that that's definitely a way to model things. I totally agree with you. But I can also try to be more accurate. I can try to incorporate this, the additional atoms, and then I will get a wave function sitting there that hybridizes with the rest. And then in transport, maybe not for big systems, but for small systems, I could see this, for instance, as a Fano resonance. So yeah.
How would that be fundamentally different from a vacancy?
Yeah, so a vacancy would mean this is a language in which you understand it. So a vacancy will give you a single vacancy will give you an exact zero mode.
You just move one day.
Yeah. Yeah, and what I'm trying to tell you is that the answer of the Hamiltonian, of the spectrum of the Hamiltonian, will be that you get one zero mode. Exactly. Okay. So now we do something else. We don't remove a vacancy. We put this CH3 over there. We play the game that I'm suggesting to game. We once again calculate the spectrum. We will not get an exact zero mode, but we will get a mode that sits close to zero. We will get a state close to the Dirac
state. It's not quite dead, but almost dead.
Right. Right, and if I care for the difference,
yeah,
then we could do that. You could say that this is there's different ways to model this. I could also just model it by an on-site energy. That's agreed. But it depends on what question I am after. Good. So there are these different ways. So how now does this order come about in the experiment? We would say a simple way to understand this order is we put all these different perturbations in different spots. And if the sample is big enough, then that will be a complicated question pattern, maybe mostly random. And that's then one realization of randomness in my experiment. So many, many, let me call those things defects. And defect is a broad name for all these type of things. Many defects, position, randomness. And this randomness is something that I can hardly reproduce from one experiment to the other. Of course, still, even though the randomness is not reproducible, what I hope is that I get something that's reproducible, else my life will be very difficult. And all those things that have the property that irrespective of how exactly I put all these impurities on in this lattice, as long as the impurity concentration, let's say, is the same, that then reproduce themselves, even though the microscopics is different, those properties I would like to call self-averaging. That has been here already on the blackboard, but because it's so important for me, I would like to repeat it. Self-averaging. These are those observables that take the same value for each and every one of these impurity realizations, so that it actually doesn't matter whether I look at a single impurity realization in a large system or at an ensemble of real impurity realizations, because in the end, each ensemble member is going to give me the same answer. So that's the concept of self-averaging. That's behind. How can it be that one big sample gives the same answer as the other big sample, even though the randomness in both samples is different? That can happen if my sample and the observable that I'm going to look at has the following property. My sample can be subdivided into boxes. I imagine that this is a macroscopic sample now. I subdivide it into boxes. And the essential assumption is that this subdivision into boxes leads to something that is homogeneous in the sense that each of these boxes looks from the statistical properties just the same, so that each box gives to my observable, each box gives to the observable the same contribution. For instance, if the observable is the density of states at a given energy, then there is a contribution from this box, from that box, from this box, and from that box to the density of states at that given energy. The signal that the experimentalist measures is going to average over all boxes. And if each of these boxes are statistically the same, then I will already measure an average, even though I'm starting with a single realization of this order in my sample.
Those have to be independent, right? Not just thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Independent. 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 Yeah, that's right. So there should be no big correlation between those boxes. And then I can use a limit theorem in order to argue that my average is going to become sharp if I have enough of these boxes. So self-averaging is very important for me. So once I understand that I would like to deal with self-averaging observables, that has two consequences. One already I mentioned. I can now deal with a theory that replaces a single disorder realization by an ensemble average, and then I come to ensemble theories of Hamiltonians, which is what Alex is going to has been explaining us so nicely to us so nicely. And the other thing that's also important for me is, and that is now important for my numerics, I might have difficulties to deal with 10 to the 23 atoms. And if it would be necessary to do this in order to be, let's say, in order to extract the qualitative or quantitative information that I would like to compare with, then I would be screwed. But if the self-averaging process thing holds true, then I might get away with a smaller sample, for instance, this one, that I can still deal with on my computer. And then instead of doing the very big system, I just do 1,000 of the smaller samples that I can deal with. And then my answer in the presence of self-averaging will not be different from the experimental answer, which does this average in one shot. So the self-averaging problem is conceptually important for the formulation of ensembles, and is of practical importance, at least if you want to do numerics in finite size systems. Good. How then please.
What is that property that you have to keep constant for all these different?
Yeah, that's what I come to now. Yeah, thank you. So now I told you why I'm motivated in ensembles. And now the next step is I will explain to you how I convert my tight binding Hamiltonian here into an ensemble of tight binding Hamiltonians. Ensemble. So tight binding, I will abbreviate by TB, Hamiltonians. And now, of course, and this is what everybody already mentioned, there's obvious ways to do it. One way would be to have the diagonal elements of this Hamiltonian be disordered. And the simplest way to have them disordered is to add to this Hamiltonian a piece which has only diagonal elements with entries epsilon n. And these entries could be drawn from some distribution. For instance, this could be a box distribution. Then this would look like this. That's a simple way to create an ensemble of random Hamiltonians. Yes?
So you're saying if I'm interested in the self-averaging property, it's enough if I take a small box and average over all disordered elements?
Not too small, obviously, but yeah.
So if the quantity were not self-averaging, then there's nothing to do.
Can I come back to this when I discuss multifractality, because then this is exactly what's going to happen. If the system is not self-averaging, then I will see this in my distribution functions, because then I will see that the distribution functions of observable per box will become very broad. And that then will allow me to study also, in principle, also to study non-self-averaging objects. But then I need to study the whole distribution function. And then it's also, I need to be careful with making predictions for experiments, because then I need to think about how in the experiment. So for instance, a typical example where self-averaging does not work at all is when you have random resistor networks and the current is just flowing with just very few preferred current paths. And to study those in a small system will be very difficult. So I'm definitely, when I talk about self-averaging, I'm definitely thinking about the situation where, for instance, the current is not dominated by just one path, but where every region of the sample more or less contributes the same things. So that's a very good question, obviously, and there's a long answer that would come with this. In many cases, though, one can play tricks. For instance, if you think about universal conductance fluctuations, then you have a given disorder realization. So that's an important question. Let me just, so that's a little excursion. Let's say I have now one sample, one impurity realization, and I measure the conductance, G, for this, and I get one number. And now I would like to change the impurity configuration, then I could see how that number changes. But that's not so easy for the experimentalists. So what they would often do is they would change the interference properties of the wave functions by adding magnetic fields. So they plot a magnetic field, B, and then because the relative phase relations of the wave function change against each other, the localization properties are affected, they get a signal, and the signal will look like this. This is a trace that is clearly specific of a given disorder realization, and that you could not get by self-averaging. Then everything would be just wiped away. But what we can do then is we can ask, what is the correlation? This is, I can think about this as kind of a random line, and then I can ask about statistical properties of that random line. And these statistical properties, again, will come out of my numerics. So it's a tricky question that you're asking. Okay, so here I have taken a box distribution. Alternatives would be a Gaussian distribution or Lorentzian distribution or bimodal distribution. There are many different ways to install the disorder here. And alternatively, and that was also already mentioned, also the Hopping matrix elements will be changed. So let's say this is A. This is, then there's B. B is delta H is 0. Delta T1, 0, and so on. Delta T1, 0. Delta T2, 0, and so on. This is a type of disorder where I only change the Hopping matrix elements from bond to bond. This one is called off-diagonal disorder. And now, a lot of recent developments, for instance, in graphene have to do with the fact that this type of disorder is interesting because at the one hand side, it introduces disorder. On the other hand side, it doesn't break the supplement lattice symmetry that I was talking about last time and Alex also was already talking about. And for that reason, one could expect that this one has different consequences for the, let's say, the density of states at zero energy as compared to this one, which breaks the sublattice symmetry. Breaking the sublattice symmetry means that delta E1, the shift on the side A, on the side 1 in lattice A, and the shift on side 2 in lattice B are different. So that means that the sublattice become different and then sublattice is broken. So this would be a diagonal disorder. So then this one would lead to, let's say, symmetry class A1, while this one would be BD1. So I have to be careful when I introduce disorder about symmetry properties. That's something we learned now. But then one could ask, well, there's also a large the amount of arbitrariness here. So there's this box distribution, Gaussian distribution, and so on. Is it actually important for what I want to say, whether what kind of distributions I'm going to use there? Question mark? Any opinion? So do I have to be very careful when I look at a certain experiment and I want to describe, let's say, how charge diffuses in this experiment? Will it be terribly important whether it's box or Gaussian distributed? Well, I have a vote. Come on, guys. I have a vote. Who is going to say that it really matters? One person. Who is going to say that it doesn't matter at all? Me too, actually. I'm saying this also. Okay. And now there will be the answer. So, yeah?
Say why? Because suppose you want to calculate the scattering rate out of one and other, you match with experiments, it may happen that one matches, the other does not. Then you cannot say, you can have results.
Okay, so yeah. So here's my argument. So this is a general argument, and here's my argument against it. Suppose we are really interested in diffusion. then the diffusion constant, and as you say correctly say, the scattering rate is the important parameter in the system. Let's say the Fermi velocity and the scattering rate are the important parameters. And now what I should have is I should have a disorder realization that I can use in order to fit these parameters. So how many parameters are there? There's the Fermi velocity that I already fitted by the bare band structure, and now I have the disorder strength, W. That's for me another fit parameter, and that I use in order to match the diffusion constant. And now to the extent that the theory that describes the physics that I'm interested in is hydrodynamic, meaning that it operates on long length scale, large time scales, and that this is characterized by just very few kinetic coefficients, I use these model parameters that I have, like the width of the distribution, maybe also the impurity concentration, in order to fit these few hydrodynamic parameters. And once I'm done with that, I can hope that I will get everything else right. And if I do the fitting well, maybe even quantitatively. That will be my argument. So now I have this parameter W, and whether I use a Gaussian versus a box thing should actually not matter so much. Of course, that I would agree with. If I now be more bold, if I use not something broad, but rather something bimodal, like this, where I have a on-site energy that is either 0 plus W over 2 or minus W over 2, P of epsilon or delta epsilon, then not only do I have this parameter W, but also have a concentration of impurities. That gives me another parameter. And then I can get physics that is referred to as non-Gaussianity and so on. So that will give then some other parameters that I can play with to get new physical regimes. OK, so far the disorder.
To be fair, you probably say it depends on the question you ask, right? There are some things that do depend on the details. If you look at Lipschitz scales and then the states.
Yeah. But that's right. But as far as if I look at the details, if I go away from generic hydrodynamic formulations, then I will be able to see this. That's correct. But for those diffusion transport type of things, this is not important. That's why I was emphasizing, as long as I'm in hydrodynamic diffusion regime, it doesn't matter.
But suppose you say that it does not matter if you take a Gaussian or a box. So when you were saying if you are going to be averaging, you'll be averaging over the that you will keep the minus W/2 plus W/2, keep one kind, that means it's Gaussian, then it's Gaussian, and then have different random configurations and then average over it.
Yeah.
But you never do an average over this and another box, because it could have if it is similar.
Okay, that I didn't get.
You can say that some of the configurations you choose from the box and some from the Gaussian.
Oh, I see. No, usually I stick to the box. But that is not a matter of principle.
If you are really not worried about that box and Gaussian will give same, then why should not you average over both?
Well, I can do it. But this, I could do it. So, but the code usually makes a choice for either, at least in my code, at least makes a choice whether either one of them. But I could actually show data where you can at least see that, let's say, critical exponents for sure. That's where one most of the time uses this. No, not most of them, but often uses this numerics.
The distribution is whatever is given to you. Whatever you start out,
that's all. You distribute.
Yeah, I take. Yeah, that's right. So if I look for rare events and so on, then of course it matters whether I allow myself to have very small, it is clear. Yeah? That physics I was sweeping under the rug. Okay, good. So I hope that now these models are very familiar to you. Then I should come to the next section, which will be giving you an example about what to do with these. Just a second.
If you have both diagonal and off-diagonal disorder, so, and if it depends on, that means diagonal depends on off-diagonal and off-diagonal depends on diagonal, that means you have both of them in that Hamiltonian. So, in which class will it fall?
Well, I mean, if then all symmetries are broken, then you will be back in A1. Yeah. Second. Transmission and localization in quasi-1D wires. And the purpose of this in the next paragraph of the lecture is to familiarize you with methods that you could use if you wanted to check what Alex told us in his colloquium. Because these will be typical methods to calculate conductances or Lyapunov exponent and critical exponents and so on. So in order to go to this Lyapunov business, it will be useful for me to remind you a bit to the transfer matrix method machinery. And in order to connect this to transport coefficients and conductances, I need to remind you of the Landau formula. Now I might be able to take a shortcut. Who is familiar with the Landau formula? Could please to do. This is maybe 20%. No, okay. This is not enough people in order to just make it very short. So let me remind you of what it is, making it medium short. Literature would be the book by Imre, Introduction to Mesoscopic Physics. Oxford UP. So here's the scenario. We imagine that we want to understand the transport process and we want to formulate it as a scattering process. So this is undergraduate quantum mechanics. We have a scattering barrier, an incoming particle with wave number k, and then reflected particle that comes back again. The weight of the reflection is characterized by a reflection amplitude, which is given as a coefficient in general complex R tilde. And then there's a transmitted amplitude with its own coefficient T twiddle. And of course, there's particle number conservation, which means that the sum squared of R twiddle and T twiddle should be 1. So the particle current is given by Vk. That's the velocity of the particle in this channel with index k multiplied with k twiddle squared. Roughly speaking, I can say that the current that goes through the barrier is proportional to the current that goes in with this velocity vk times the transmission probability, which is in this setup just t twiddle k. Now, what I really do in my experiment and what I would like to understand is not so much what happens per k. What I would like to know is what happens per energy. And so I need to sum all those k states that are in a certain energy window, which means that the particle current per energy that I can understand as a sum over incoming k's summed over the phase space times the contribution for every k times delta function that makes sure that I only sum over those contributions that sit in my energy window. Now, when I do this integral, then this combination of vk times dk is very handy, because that allows me immediately to rewrite this integral as an integral over the energy, and then I can easily do it because there is a delta function. So let me recall, Vk is given as a derivative of the dispersion of the particle with respect to its momentum, h bar k. If I use this and plug it in there, then I see that it says dk times the derivative of epsilon with respect to dk. So I can easily rewrite this. This then is d epsilon divided by 2 pi. This is this 2 pi divided by h bar. This is this h bar multiplied with t twiddle k, which now is a function of energy, or first epsilon, and then later energy, squared delta of E less epsilon of k, where I've been using this dispersion relation in order to convert k into a function of epsilon. And now I can, as I said, easily do this. And then what I get is that the current per energy is given by T k of E modulus squared. Good. So this object, I then would like to identify with the transmission probability of a particle current that goes in with energy E. T of E is defined as T twiddle K of E modulus squared. And if I want to, then I can make contact here with the particle current. I can say this is a particle current per energy that I write like this, dI dE. Now, if I write I, then this is usually the symbol for an electric current. If I want a particle current, then I should divide it by the charge of the particle that enters. So the transmission is essentially dI dE. That's a message of the Landauer formula. To rewrite it in common terms, I introduce the conductance G, which is defined as the slope of the electric current with respect to the bias voltage, which I can also rewrite as the slope with respect to energy. But then I should take the difference energy, divide it by minus E. Because if I convert the bias into an energy, then it means I multiply with the charge of the particle. So I need to multiply with the charge of the particle over there also. And now I can use here the expression that I had before, which then gives me this is E squared over H times T of E. And now I've somehow screwed up with an H bar. Where did I screw up? Already here, yeah? One over, no, this looks strange. Okay, wait, I know how to solve this problem. So we write 2p, and then we write h bar equal to 1. I hope that's acceptable. So really, this in conventional units, this is e squared over h. And then this prefix